Painter Momopie, a game I immediately fell in complete love with. Seriously, I saw it originally on a Twitch stream where someone played it for about 15 seconds. At the time, I had no idea what it even was. I immediately jumped on GameFAQs and searched the entire Game Boy library, I kid you not, just to figure out what this was. That's how much I really wanted to play this game. And for the most part, it's really damn good. For the most part. Now you play as this cute little witch, presumably Momopie-chan, as she, if we're tying this to the title, paints the floor, although it looks more like she's using a push broom to sweep it. So I guess it's more like you're playing Kiki's cousin, whose job is to clean a castle for a king as an indentured servant, I guess. Now, the moment you see gameplay, I'm sure the first thing your mind jumps to is Pac-Man. And you're kinda sort of right, but also partially wrong. It is a game where you have a top-down view of what is essentially a maze, and you have to cover all of the maze in order to complete the level. However, there are some key differences. First and foremost is the overall design of the maps, because Pac-Man maps were designed with the whole idea of using loops. Like, just go take a look at the Pac-Man map for a sec. It is basically a loop within a loop within a loop containing smaller loops, and that actually affords you a lot of strategy in the sense that no matter what situation you're in, you always have an escape route, you know, provided you don't have a ghost on either side of you, whereas Painter Momopie has dead ends. That immediately probably makes you jump to the conclusion, well, then you're completely screwed, right? Well, yes, and also no, because another difference between Painter Momopie and Pac-Man is the fact that there aren't any power pellets. But while there are no pickups that will make you able to take out your opponents and essentially be invincible for a matter of moments, you instead have magic. So you activate the magic screen and you can see three different magics. You have Pion, which is basically a missile. Don't get too excited, it's not as fantastic as that sounds, but it is the most effective way of handling anything in this game. You have a speed up, which, self-explanatory. And you have this thing, Sealed, which I think is a mistranslation of Shield. There's a few mistranslations in this game. But, near as I can tell, this does nothing. Because I've tried activating it and walking through an enemy, I died. I've tried walking through, like, little dust clouds that temporarily block off your paths, which, that's really cool. Creating, like, little miniature temporary barriers, that's a genuinely cool idea, but that didn't help either. The only thing I can maybe think it's useful for is protecting you against the, like, one enemy that has a projectile attack, maybe? And that's pretty rare to run into, so I've never actually seen functional use out of this magic. No, most of the time you'll probably just be using your little magic missiles to take out opponents. But because there is an MP bar and each magic costs different values of magic points, magic becomes a very important resource that you have to manage. Yeah! Resource management! This game is awesome like that! Now, if we go back to the key theme of me trying to explain why this isn't just Pac-Man on the Game Boy, you know, aside from the fact it's got a cute little magic witch that makes me like this game infinitely more than Pac-Man, another thing you have to consider is whereas something like Pac-Man was just a straight arcade game, this one's more of a puzzle game. Now, it doesn't look like that immediately. Very early on, the levels are very freeform in how you approach them. Sure, there are optimal paths you can take, but for the most part, you're not really forced to follow any strict guide as to how to complete any level in any way. However, later on, I noticed a few levels where, as far as I was able to discern, there's only one or two ways you could actually complete the level. Like, level 8. I was stuck on this level for the longest time, because it's a very narrow corridor that is basically one way, and about towards the 85% the way through the corridor, a ghost spawns. And this ghost can move through walls, it automatically tracks you, and you can't kill it with your missiles. And near as I can tell, the only way I actually managed to beat this level was to just spam speed up and hopefully get through the level before the enemy spawns. And that only happened 1 out of 10 times that I tried that strategy. Like, seriously, the timing on that was just so bloody strict. Or later, there was this one area where I ran into these slimes, which will muck up your floor and you have to go over it again. The way I had done it ended with the slimes being stuck in this one corridor at the very bottom of the screen, going back and forth in the same corridor. And I couldn't get into the corridor without killing them, and I had no magic. So there's definitely failure states to this game where you're able to continue, but you can't actually complete the level. And some levels feel like they're designed specifically around this gimmick, and I'm not really sure I enjoy that. Another thing that I don't care much for about this game is the fact that it just feels unfinished. I mean, there are those aforementioned typos, which, congratulation, but also in this scene with the king, he supposedly presents you with a bonus prize, which is randomized, so, hooray, randomness. Oh wait, no, the other thing, boo, randomness. But you pick your prize, and then you get this magic, but the thing is, near as I can tell, this magic doesn't actually do anything. Like, you can pick up magic that you already have, but it doesn't reduce the cost of that magic, near as I can tell. It doesn't automatically equip you with that magic. It doesn't give you free uses or anything. And then there's magic that just doesn't show up on your inventory screen. So I'm not sure if I'm just doing something wrong or I'm missing something completely, but it feels like the entire prize from the king, like this extra magic, just wasn't implemented, but they kept the little scene where you get to pick it for reasons. Oh, and again, to prove how unfinished this is, in the mid-teens, I ran into level 2 again. Not in the sense that I was automatically teleported back to level 2, in the sense that it's the exact same map. And the maps typically get progressively harder, so it was weird to go back to a previous map with the previous map's difficulty, and like, just clearing it instantaneously. It just felt like it was needless padding. And the weird thing is, it was level 2, it's not like they used level 1 prior, they just used level 2 again, for some reason. I genuinely don't know. And that's the thing about this game. I don't like how it forces you to go into certain levels with an exact, specific way of going about it, and if you just don't execute properly, you lose. I don't like how unfinished it is, but I can laugh at the typos, why not? Basically, underneath a thick layer of grime, there is a shining, fantastic game. But unfortunately, the indentured servant witch was too busy getting caught by ghosts in a hallway because she didn't move too fast to clean it. I still like it, though. The presentation of Painter Momopie is kinda hit and miss. Visually, it's pretty fantastic. Sure, there's not too many different tile sets, but there's a bunch of different enemies. I counted probably at least a dozen, maybe more. I love Momopie's sprite, I love her animation when she dies and when she's just cleaning. I think she's just a cute sprite. And I just genuinely like the creative enemies. And they all seem to have their own different sort of AI pattern too. Like, there's this one enemy that's like a giant hand that follows an exact specific pattern that's exclusive to it, which is really cool. Like, I like the AI and how the different enemies seem to have their own exact way of doing things. It gives their unique sprites their own unique personality, and I love that. As for the sound, however, there's like two songs in this game, and honestly, before playback, I didn't even realize there was a second song. I thought it was just the same first song on repeat again. I genuinely wasn't paying attention at that point. So that's not exactly ideal. Now, if you want to get a copy of Painter Momopie on the Game Boy, good hunting, sir or madam. Seriously, I've only ever seen 3 copies on all of eBay, and they've all been above $120, including the copy I got, which was sitting at that for over a year. I sat there, and I watched it, and I watched it, and I watched it, and I think eventually the seller just got sick of it and put it at like a $1 auction, and at that point I was just having a bad week, so I was prepared to just bid up to that point anyway, but I didn't even have to get half as close to that, which is nice. Yeah, I've only seen 3 of these on eBay, and they're ridiculously expensive, so I'm not sure if they're rare, but people are certainly charging them like they're rare, and I don't see them frequently, which is not terribly, terribly encouraging. This is also the game that kicked off my, like, 5 or 6 import Game Boy games I've been obsessing about for over a year now, and on the bright side, as of this week, I got 2 more of them, so I'm, like, halfway through. Now I just need the other ones that are also ridiculously expensive, but Painter Momopie was the one that kicked off my sort of obsession with these obscure import Game Boy games last year, and, well, I think it's only fitting that I got it first. And I certainly love it. It's got its flaws, sure, but it's also got a cute witch that has swept her way into my heart and cleaned the turmoil out of my life. Well, at least when I play this game.